My name is Mumia Abu-Jamal. I'm on death row in Pennsylvania. I'm ex-president of the Association of Black Journalists in Philadelphia. I'm still a continuing revolutionary journalist. I write for anybody who wants me to write for them. And I'm fighting my conviction, fighting the sentence, fighting for my life, and fighting to create revolution in America. Yes, I am a political prisoner.
From death row, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal.
It was the eruption of the civil rights movement against Jim Crow segregation that shattered the McCarthyite Cold War climate of the 50s. The whole world watched as peaceful demonstrations demanding the right to vote were attacked by the police and the Ku Klux Klan. The civil rights movement challenged racist white America and gave rise to a generation of young radicals. But it did not lead to black freedom.
Revolution means change. It means total change.
When the movement came north in the mid-60s, it collided head-on with economic and social reality. The hellish conditions of ghetto life, the mass chronic unemployment, racist police brutality, these could only be solved through social revolution.
Very recently, the Census Bureau said something like 31 million people were in poverty. Other records say that there's 3.1 million people who are homeless in America. You've got people who do not have the basic needs fulfilled. They can't eat, they can't have shelter, they can't have clothing.
In Chicago in 1966, the struggle for racial equality meant a confrontation with the political machine of Democratic Party Mayor Richard Daley. After being stoned in the racist white enclave of Marquette Park, Martin Luther King called off a planned march for nearby Cicero. When 200 demonstrators from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, went ahead with the Cicero March, they were met by a howling, brick-throwing mob. The civil rights movement was stopped in its tracks. It was during this time that Mumia Abu-Jamal came of political age. In 1967, as a young high school student, Jamal, then known as Wes Cook, was already a fighter.
As a youth in the 60s, I was impressed by the black power movement that was sweeping black America and the black world in Africa and the Caribbean.
He was one of the leaders of a mass movement to rename Benjamin Franklin High School for Malcolm X, part of a citywide battle for black studies in the public high schools, which culminated in a protest at school board headquarters on November 17, 1967. The Philadelphia police attacked the student protest. The police were led by Police Commissioner Frank Rizzo.
So, I remember me and a brother named Eddie Jones and a few other brothers, about four or five brothers in North Philly, went to a demonstration in South Philadelphia. It's at the Philadelphia Spectrum, which is a big sporting arena. This was 1968, and it was the presidential nomination of George Corley Wallace III, I think that's his name. He was running for president on the American Independent Party. In retrospect, it's kind of crazy to think that we would go down to a demonstration in South Philadelphia, which is like predominantly white, and protest against George Wallace coming to Philadelphia. But at that time, you know, we believed that it was our city as well. So we did it, and every one of us got our asses kicked. By plainclothes policemen. You probably heard the tale, I beat you so bad your own mama won't love you. Well, it has a particular relevance to me because as I was laying in the hospital, charged with assault and aggravated assault and beating a police officer, my own mother walked by me, looked me dead in the eyes and kept walking because she couldn't recognize me. I was beaten, unrecognizable. I was in my mid-teens at that time. From that period, and from those experiences, from me having to go through the hell of that, and seeing the complete lack of power of people to resist that, I was attracted to the Black Panther Party. So because there was not a functioning, active Black Panther Party at that time, we founded one and built one in Philadelphia. I was beaten into the Black Panther Party.
Revolution has come. The Black Panther Party represented the best of a generation of militant black youth. They rejected the turn-the-other-cheek pacifism of Martin Luther King and stood for armed self-defense.
Revolution has come. I believe that it's a natural right and principle of life for all people to defend themselves. I believe that years ago when I was a Panther, I believe it when I got exposed to the MOVE organization, I believe it now. Self-defense is a natural right, you know, and no one can take that away from you.
There was a national campaign to destroy the Black Panthers by infiltration, arrest, and murder, designed and carried out by the White House and J. Edgar Hoover's FBI. This program killed 38 Panthers. The FBI mandate was to disrupt and destroy the Black Panther Party, including by fabricating evidence and perjured testimony. From May 1967 to December 1969, the Panthers were hit with 768 arrests and almost 5 million in bail bonds.
The COINTELPRO program was a terroristic program. Its function was to terrorize radicals, revolutionaries, opponents of government programs, and to stigmatize and isolate them from the general population.
In September 1969, the police raided the party headquarters at 19th and Columbia. They would have shot us then, Jamal said, except for the community presence. The office was ransacked, files taken, mimeograph machine gone. On December 4, 1969, Chicago Panther leaders Fred Hampton and Mark Clark were murdered by the Chicago police under the direction of the FBI. A week later, in Philadelphia's Church of the Advocate, Jamal was the first speaker at a 1,000-strong memorial for their slain comrades. He said, "The only thing on Hampton's bed was blood and a book by Lenin. He was murdered. We're trying to tell people that there is no need for any more Fred Hamptons or Bobby Huttons."
In all the years that I was a Panther and before I became a Panther, make no mistake, the government tried very viciously to wipe out the Black Panther Party. The point is, they tried to kill Panthers. They shot, they sent in grenades, they bombed, they did all that stuff.
A month after the murder of Hampton and Clark, in January 1970, at the height of COINTELPRO, the Philadelphia Panthers were featured in a front-page Philadelphia Inquirer article. Their spokesman was 16-year-old Jamal, Minister of Information of the branch. Explaining their free breakfast program, Jamal said, "The Black Panther Party is doing what the churches are supposed to do." He continued saying, "Genocide is coming to the forefront under Nixon, Agnew, and Mitchell regime. And that's exactly what it is. The Panther Party is an uncompromising party. It faces reality." That summer, 1970, Jamal joined the staff of the Panther National Office in California and wrote for the party's newspaper, The Black Panther.
My career as a journalist began with the Black Panther newspaper in Philadelphia and on the Black Panther newspaper in California. There is where I learned how to write, learned how to right from a revolutionary perspective, perhaps.
On August 29, 1970, Police Commissioner Rizzo staged multiple raids on Panther offices around the city. Panther members were stripped in the street. Less than a week later, the Black Panther Party convened the Revolutionary People's Constitutional Convention at Temple University in Philadelphia. Jamal returned from California and served on the security team. Jamal's Panther activity did not go unnoticed by government authorities.
In my case, where you have the police who moved against me since a youth because of my Black Panther history and before, with no criminal background, the political nature is clearly evident.
He was named in a House of Representatives Committee report on internal security. The government bided its time.
They sent letters, smut letters, from husbands to wives, you know? They sent letters to employers, you know, stigmatizing people. They sent letters from one radical organization to another radical organization to try to incite violence between those two organizations. In fact, in the Black Panther Party out in L.A. in 1973, I think it was, in 1969, I believe, was a brother named Bunchy Carter, who was killed because of a conflict with the US organization, because there were letters going between the organizations that were not authored by Panthers. They were authored by FBI agents in some dark office in California to incite hatred and division between radical groups.
In the end, the Black Panther Party was destroyed by both police terror from without and a murderous internal factionalism inflamed by COINTELPRO provocations. During the next 10 years, Jamal wrote and broadcast. His voice was heard on the National Black Network and many Philadelphia radio stations. His work was guided by the, quote, principle that we are oppressed black human beings first. He was elected president of the Philadelphia chapter of the Association of Black Journalists at age 26 in November 1980. He was named by Philadelphia Magazine as one of its people to watch in 1981. He became known as the voice of the voiceless, and among those voiceless was the MOVE organization.
I met MOVE while covering them in Philadelphia. I became exposed to them as opposed to reading about them, and found out that what I read about them had no relationship to the kind of people they were and what they were about. That every published report was tinged with prejudice and hatred. MOVE members have been active and above ground in Philadelphia since 1973. They've been through every jail in Philadelphia. They've been beaten in every police district all over Philadelphia for standing up for their belief to defend life.
The police will be in there to drag them out by the backs of their necks.
There will be a confrontation this time. There will be no barricades.
I don't know. It's up to them whether they... No barricades, Mike. They're going to be taken by force if they resist. No question about that. Children or not.
In 1978, Frank Rizzo escalated the war on the MOVE organization. The MOVE commune in Philadelphia's Powelton Village was razed by police bulldozers. An army of police fired untold rounds into the house despite the presence of children. Former Panther Delbert Africa was savagely beaten.
Kicking him on the head. I have no idea. I just couldn't see.
Get up!
During the police crossfire, one cop was killed.
There was an incredible response by the city. I'm talking like 700 cops. A siege around the neighborhood. And it really continued day by day, until it built up until August 8, 1978, which is the case of a police assault on MOVE headquarters, maybe 500 policemen. What people may not know is that the arms that MOVE had were inoperable, that they were there to show the police that MOVE was serious about defending the home, but they had no firing pins. They couldn't work.
Jamal covered the MOVE story and attended the August 8th press conference, which Rizzo called to defend brutal assault.
The press has to take a little of the blame here. They've glorified a bunch of criminals. A new breed of journalism that doesn't want both sides. Only one side of the issue. The press is responsible for what's happening in this city.
Jamal became, in his own words, a widely known and among cops, widely hated MOVE supporter who went to jails to get the Africa's side of the August 8th, 78 confrontation. He was deeply impressed by the refusal of MOVE members to be broken during the trial for the death of the cop.
I was seduced into the MOVE organization by the loveliness and goodness of its people and its members. I was probably enraged as well. As sitting in a trial in an official capacity, objective as a journalist, and seeing that the law really didn't matter, that it didn't matter whether a man was innocent or guilty. It didn't matter what the law says, your rights were. You just had nine members of the MOVE organization being sentenced to 30 to 100 years for a crime that everybody knew they did not commit. I mean, nine people cannot kill one man. What you had in Philadelphia in 81 was the naked state judicial terrorism of the Philadelphia judiciary against the MOVE organization. It was like, let's wipe them out. It's impossible for me to say what my feelings were in that time. Sitting in a courtroom, seeing that kind of naked injustice, it rankled me to the core.
In 1985, the state's vendetta against MOVE culminated in Mayor Wilson Good's bombing of the Osage Avenue house, which left 11, including 5 children, dead.
It was the Philadelphia Police Department. It was the state government of Pennsylvania. It was the FBI, the ATF of the U.S. government, who bombed MOVE people on May 13, 1985. But no one would call any of those organizations or their employer, the U.S. government, terrorists. But why weren't they? They created mass murder, Holocaust, in a major city in America, and not one of them have ever been charged with any crime at all. Only Ramona Africa, guilty only of survival, is in jail following May 13, 1985.
Because he was an outspoken partisan of the oppressed and defender of the MOVE organization, at age 26, Jamal was well known throughout the city. On December 9, 1981, he was accused of the killing of a cop on the streets of Philadelphia. Jamal saw a cop beat his brother, who had been stopped for an alleged traffic violation. Jamal rushed in, taking a near-fatal bullet in the stomach. When the smoke cleared, the cop was dead. Jamal was sitting on a curb, bleeding profusely. Even the day after he was arrested, the Philadelphia Inquirer headlined, quote, "Jamal, an eloquent activist not afraid to raise his voice," close quote.
Yeah, I was charged with homicide of a police officer in Philadelphia. I was convicted of murder in the first degree and sentenced to death.
Denied his request to represent himself and resources to prepare his defense. Of the prospective black jurors, all but one were excluded because of their race, while admittedly prejudiced white jurors were chosen to decide Jamal's fate. One prosecution witness said she saw a short man of roughly 200 pounds shoot the cop. Jamal was 6 feet, 1 inch, and 170 pounds at the time. A white cab driver testified but the shooter wore an afro. Jamal wore dreadlocks. Jamal had 15 character witnesses, one of them the renowned poet Sonia Sanchez, whom, incredibly, the judge slandered as a friend of cop killers.
One of the things that links my background with MOVE Organization and with the Black Panther Party is that the sentencing hearing, the sentencing phase of the trial, the prosecutor introduced an article from the Philadelphia Inquirer, which was an interview with me when I was a young teen, when I was Lieutenant of Information of the Black Panther Party, and cross-examined me on that article, you know.
The DA used Jamal's membership in the Black Panther Party 12 years earlier to convince the jury that he was a committed cop killer. DA, do you recall saying, "All power to the people"? Jamal, yes. DA, do you believe your actions as well as your philosophy are consistent with the quote, "political power grows out the barrel of a gun"? Jamal, I believe that America has proven that to be true. DA, do you recall saying, "The Panther Party is an uncompromising party. It faces reality"? Jamal, yes. Jamal further went on to say, "It is clear that political power grows out the barrel of a gun, or else America wouldn't be here today. It is America who seized political power from the Indian race, not by God, not by Christianity, not by goodness, but by the barrel of a gun."
The word Black Panther means different things to different people depending on their perspective, depending on their history, depending on their political orientation. And the prosecutor knew that exceedingly well. So that was used to bring back the death penalty. And I saw when it hit the jury, it was like a bolt of electricity. Pow.
In February 1990, the Pennsylvania Supreme Court turned down his petition for rehearing. Jamal remains in solitary confinement in Huntington Prison.
My daily life is 24 to 22 hours in a cage, in a cell, much like this joint here, except it's got a toilet. But all prisons have. I and other MOVE members in Pennsylvania State have been in what's called disciplinary custody, locked down in the holes in prisons, because we refuse to cut our hair and violate our faith, which is the teachings of John Africa. It's ironic that the state that was the birthplace of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights can deny the right of religion and faith to anyone willy-nilly. I have several children, I'm married. It's kind of difficult for me to talk about the personal situation because, as you see, I mean, you know, I can't hold my children, hug my wife. I kind of tend to not address those kinds of things. It is personal. That is not to say that it ain't real. It is very real.
Look at Jamal's case, because the death sentence is not an accident. Because Jamal's case is what the death penalty is all about. Would he be on death row if he were not black? Not a Black Panther. Not a MOVE supporter. Not a powerful voice of the oppressed.
The campaign is building. It's growing by leaps and bounds in Europe, in West Germany, in the Netherlands. In India, of all places, we're getting, you know, responses from people around the world. We believe that on the legal issues, it's strong, but we can never ignore the political issues. In a lot of ways, when you look at the number of people across America who are sentenced to death, when you look at the polls that say that this wide range of America wants the death penalty, you know, we can't ignore that. We have to take that into account. But the work continues and the campaign builds, and we will prevail.
We must prevail. But it will be a fight. Jamal and all death row prisoners need the power of labor, the power of a mass movement to abolish the death penalty. The campaign to save Mumia Abu-Jamal is the political struggle against the racist death penalty in the U.S. and internationally.
Your international voice of protest becomes a sweet song of hope for the thousands of us in the United States sitting on the brink of death. I'm honored to join you and this noble fight. On the move from death row, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal.
A revolutionary journalist and activist, an honorary award-holding citizen in over 20 cities, with a street named after him in France, his case is said to be one of the most debated in modern legal history. Accused of killing a police officer in the 80s, Mumia Abu-Jamal has spent almost three decades on death row. In January, he was taken off death row and is now serving life behind bars without parole. For the first time since his transferal, he's speaking exclusively with RT from jail. Thank you so much for speaking with us today. My first question to you is, after almost 30 years on death row and now serving a life sentence without parole, if you weren't behind bars right now, if you could be anywhere else in the world, where do you think you would be, and what would you be doing?
Well, it depends on my frame of mind. I've always been, since my earliest years, what one would call an internationalist. That is, I pay attention to what's happening in other parts of the world, and as an internationalist, I'm thinking about life lived by other people all around the world. Of course, as an African-American, I would love to spend some time in parts of Africa, Nigeria, Kenya, Ghana, West Africa for the most part, because that's where most African-Americans hail from. But it's also true that I have many friends and loved ones in France. I would like to...
This call is from the State Correctional Institution at Mahanoy and is subject to monitoring and recording.
I would like to spend some time in France. I would really like to bring my family, my wife, and my kids to come see our street in Paris.
That's right, because you have a street named after you in France. Now, Mumia, I was wondering, being behind bars, you seem to be watching world affairs much closer than most people who are free to walk the streets. And I want to ask you, which event of the last 30 years would you really want to be a part of, if you could?
I think first would probably be the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa, because, of course, while it was South African, it was also global, because it was the touch point of white supremacy versus the freedom and dignity of African people. So South Africa would certainly be a, you know, logical first choice. But wherever people are fighting for freedom, you know, that kind of whets my appetite and it gets my attention and moves my passion.
You turn 58 at the end of the month, which means you will have spent more than half of your life behind bars, and most people can't even begin to imagine that. What is it like? How has it changed you?
Well, I think in some ways I'm that same guy, and in many ways it's impossible for me to be that guy. The point of fact, I've spent most of my life, the bigger percentage of my life, on death row, and it cannot have had a profound effect on consciousness and on the way one sees and interacts with the world. I like to tell myself that I've actually spent a lot of that time beyond the bars and in other countries and, you know, in other parts of the world, because I did so mentally. But, you know, mental can only take you so far. The truth of the matter is I spent most of my living years in my lifetime on death row. So, in many ways, even to this day, in my own mind, if not in fact, I'm still on death row.
Your story has really become a symbol for many of a flawed justice system. Do you personally have any faith left in a fair and free justice system? You've described in your work the prison system in the United States as the war on the poor, prisons being built to get rid of the broke and the homeless. Do you have any faith left in that system at all, considering you are obviously so much part of it and your life has been so much affected by it?
Well, while it's true that I have very little faith in the system today, it's also true that I had very little faith in the system when I was a young person, when I was even a teenager. That's because when I looked around me, you know, I saw the face of repression, if not the same thing we have today, but at a greater, more intense level. You could not say in the 1970s, or the 1960s at least, that the American community suffered from mass incarceration. Today you can say that in a way, in a scope that was frankly quite unthinkable back then. When I was a teenager and I was in the Black Panther Party, I remember going to downtown Manhattan and protesting against the political imprisonment and incarceration and the threats facing Angela Y. Davis. And I remember, you know, of course, like many other Panthers, reading her works and finding when she attacked the prison system, she talked about the perhaps 250,000 or 300,000 people imprisoned all throughout the United States as not just a problem that need to be dealt with, but a crisis, a situation that bordered on fascism. Well, fast forward 30, 40 years until the present, there are more than 300,000 prisoners in California alone, one state out of 50. The imprisonment in California, notice I'm not talking about the United States, but in California alone exceeds that of France, of Belgium, of England, and perhaps I could name four or five other countries combined. So we could not perceive back then of what it would become. And, you know, so it's monstrous when you really look at what's happening today. You can literally talk about millions of people being part, that is, incarcerated by the prison industrial complex today, men, women, and children. And that level of mass incarceration, really mass repression, has to have an immense impact and effect on the outer community, not just among families, but in a social and communal consciousness way, and the inculcation of fear among generations. So it's at a level and at a depth that many of us could not even fathom or dream of today.
You know, I can't help but wonder, you talk about so many important social and economic issues in your work. Do you have a dream today? If you could see one of those aspects changed, which one would you pick? What do you wish you could see happen in the United States?
There's never one thing. I mean, it's a sexy question, and I understand it, and I will address it. But the point is, because the system is a system of interconnectedness, and because one part of the system impacts another part of the system, and because what Antonio Gramsci called hegemony of the ideological system impacts other parts of the system, you can't change one thing that'll impact all things. I think, if anything, that's one of the lessons of the 1960s, because the civil rights movement was talking about, say, integration, this and that, and changing the schools. In point of fact, if you look at the vast majority of working class and poor black kids in American schools today, they live and spend their hours and their days in a system profoundly as segregated as that of their grandparents. But it's not segregated by race, it's segregated by race and class, formally class, which impacts race. The great Jonathan Kozol, who has researched American education for 40 years, has written in one of his most recent books that the American educational system is an apartheid system. I know from my personal interaction with my own family, you know, talking to my wife and my kids and even the grandkids, that the schools that my grandchildren go to are worse than the schools I went to when I was in my minor years and in my teenage years. That's a condemnation of a system. But because former generations only concentrated on one thing or one side of the problem, the problems really got worse and worse and worse. And while there's a lot of rhetoric about schools, American schools are a tragedy. That's the only thing they can be called. Well, I would rephrase that. American schools in many of the black and Latino communities are not a tragedy. They are a crime.
You were monitored by the FBI at the age of 14, and I want to ask you, now with laws such as the NDAA being passed in the United States, where people are watched, detained, and can be held, that's become easier than ever. Do you think Big Brother has officially shown his face in this country at this point?
Well, let's look at it this way. If you look back at the COINTELPRO era, if you look back at the COINTELPRO era in those files, of not just me, but hundreds of thousands of people who were active in the Black Liberation Movement, in the Women's Liberation Movement, in the anti-war movement, even in the Animal Liberation Movement, all these movements that we're supposedly have the constitutional right to participate in. What is clear is that the FBI and their leaders and their agents knew that everything they did then was illegal. And FBI agents were taught and trained how to break into places, how to do what they call black bag jobs and that kind of stuff, how to commit crimes. But this is what they were also told. You better do it and you better not get caught, because if you get caught, you're going to jail and we'll act like we don't know you. You're on your own. what has happened in the last 20 and 30 years? Well, not just the NDAA, but the so-called Patriot Act has made everything that was illegal back in the 1960s and 1950s and 1970s, they've legalized it. They've legalized the very things that FBI agents and administrators knew was criminal back then. That means they can look in your mail, they certainly can read your email, they tap your phones, they do all of that, but they do it in the name of national security, but they do it nonetheless. What we live in today is a national security state where Big Brother is legalized, rationalized.
You've described politicians once as prostitutes in suits, giving your apologies to honest prostitutes. So I want to ask you, it's election season in the United States right now. Who do people trust? Who would you vote for?
Nobody, frankly. I mean, let me put it this way. I have seen no one that I could, in good conscience, vote for today. Because most of the people that are out there are the two major political parties. And when they talk, you know, all I hear is a kind of madness, an unreasonableness. A wish to return to days of yore, the 1950s, or they talk about the perpetuation of the American empire, imperialism. My God, I mean, what is there to vote for? How many people consciously, when they go to the polls, are voting for imperialism, or voting for more war, or voting for their son?
This call is from the State Correctional Institution at Mahanoy and is subject to monitoring and recording.
Son or daughter or father or mother, for that matter, to become a member of the armed forces and become a mass murderer.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
A bomber.
Sir, can I just ask you very quickly, since we have 60 seconds, I just want to ask you lastly. You seem to have endorsed the Occupy Wall Street movement that has sprung up all over the United States this year.
Right.
Is this the type of uprising that you think could change America and do good for the United States?
I think it's the beginning of the kind of uprising, because it has to be deeper, it has to be broader, it has to address issues that are touching on the lives of poor and working class people. I think it has a ways to go
you
to make
30
that.
30 seconds remaining.
But I think it's a damn good beginning. I just wish it was bigger and angrier.
Since our time is running out, Mumia, can I ask you, you're the voice of the voiceless. What is your message to your supporters today, right now, who are listening to you?
In the words of Kwame Ture, organize, 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 and I love you all, and I thank you for fighting for me. Now let's fight together to be free.
Thank you so much for your time today. Thank you for talking with us. The best of luck
thank
to you.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I make to the corner when I make it. And that's where I make the take it. Don't make